Hello. So, what is this? Why do you care? And how can you actually use it? So, this is a training video to show you how you can take your day-to-day work and have it be aligned with your company's year-long overall strategic goals. So, why do you care? Because whenever your work is aligned with the company's overall strategic goals, everybody wins. So that doesn't matter if you're an individual person within a company or if you're an agency like Seer Interactive, where we have multiple different departments and we want to know the overall strategy of a company so with that we can figure out what we can do to help. So, how do you actually do that? Because a lot of that information should be obvious. It would be great if there was this magical place that would give you a company's overall year-long strategy and lay it out in a very clear and easy and actionable document. That doesn't exist, but this is a way that we can get somewhat closer to that. So, publicly traded companies in the United States have to file an annual report. The fancy name for it is a 10-K report. There's also 10-Q reports that are done on a quarterly basis, but basically it has a lot of information that the company basically describes the kind of things like how things went and what they're planning for the future. So it looks like this scary looking 124-page document. Realistically, very few people are going to be able to read through and understand all of this and be able to have something actionable from it. So what we're trying to do is take the most useful parts for us that we can actually take an actionable step upon. Not every document will have the same thing, and it may not necessarily name them the same. But for the most part, if you look for something like the word forward, you'll find something called a forward-looking statement. In other words, strategy. And because this is an annual report, in general, they're trying to describe this as the year-long future strategy. So, looking at this, Peloton's actually one of the better outlines of this because they actually have it in an outline. Sometimes it's a giant paragraph and it's very hard to read, and it's even harder to actually make heads or tails of it. So, what we're going to do is take this and put it into ChatGPT. And I know that there's a lot of different controversy around what it can or can't do, should it be writing content, etc. One of the base functions that it has, what it's actually built upon, is it looks a large language model. It takes a lot of text and it tries to understand it. And that's exactly what we need it to do right now. So we're taking this large piece of text, this large piece of forward-looking statement, and we're going to ask ChatGPT to outline and summarize it, to group or regroup what we have, and then output it in a way that's easier for us to read. So let's see how it does. So you can see how that's very unstructured. I'm not doing too much for it. And right now it's actually rewriting it and grouping it into something that makes a lot more sense for me. Like, I know what cost-saving measures are, strategies and plans, market growth, and it's all done that within a few seconds. So now, instead of something that looks like this, I can read something that looks like this. That's a lot more actionable for me. Obviously, I've read this before, but, and I'm not gonna do that at this moment, but here, what we can see are the company is interested in cost-saving measures. There's some restructuring going on. So, as an agency, maybe that lets me know that we should be offering different efficiencies right now. Maybe it's the time to look at whatever we have and see how we can do more with less. That's something that we should always be doing, but some companies are more in a growth stage and they're looking more at adding rather than optimizing what is currently there. So that tells me the kind of things that I might want to help push forward. Another area that we can see here is there's market growth and there might be some demand for that. So maybe that means, in this case, the connected fitness products industry. Putting my SEO hat on, does that mean that we're going to make any future acquisitions? Does that mean that we're going to create a whole bunch of new pages or sections? Does it mean that we should re-examine the existing content that we have? to revamp it in some way, shape, or form. So those are different questions that I can ask my point of contact and the point of contact at Peloton and say, hey, in the next 12 months, do we have anything planned for the connected fitness products? Maybe we can help you out. We can also look at, there's something going on with declining sales for products Bike and Bike Plus. So maybe we can have our strategy and analytics team take a look at where the sources of decline in sales could be. And if it's related to the search channel, maybe that's something that we can help support or temporarily support, like through some kind of PPC or display. A few other things that I see are safety, legal concerns. So it's not, we don't live in a perfect world. Products are always going to have issues. However, if we see that there's enough demand for this, and obviously there's strategic focus on this in terms of safety issues, product recalls, it's much better if Peloton is the number one result for that rather than some other site that's out there. Partly it's an ethical thing where a company should be responsible for the products that they have, but also it's a competitive thing where if some other site has and collects all that information, then that is somebody that they're being taken away from your site and they're going to, your customers are going to a different site. And then lastly, we're looking at, there's, in this case, it's a rapidly changing environment. There are a lot of new competitors. For us, does that mean that we should do more comparison pages like Peloton versus such and such a product? Should we highlight the different features and what differentiates Peloton from some of our competitors? Should we do a little bit more analysis into seeing who is a fast mover that might be challenging things? So this is all stuff that I wouldn't have been able to get had I just tried to look through the original 10K statement. And this makes it a lot quicker and easier for me to guide the conversation towards things that matter to the company overall and are the big strategies so that every one of my day-to-day small tactics aligns much better with the overall strategies. Here's a small pro tip. It's not perfect, but sometimes, again, if you're strapped for time, you can add a flag where I want to flag anything that's related to SEO, PPC, and business intelligence. That's basically what our strategy and analytics team would be more commonly called, and add flags to this. So it's not going to be perfect, but it makes it a lot easier for me to identify things that I can action upon. So it didn't catch everything. Now, if I look through for hashtag SEO, competing effectively in a competitive market, this time it didn't do as great of a job at identifying those things, but sometimes every little bit helps. That's it. Hopefully you can start looking at very large 10K statements and being able to summarize things like forward-looking statements. I didn't get the opportunity, but we could do something similar for all the different risks. And we can actually, you know what? Let's go ahead and do that right now. So these are the risk factors. I haven't done this before, so we will see how this works out. But let's say we want to, so those are all of our risks, right? So the thing that I had before outlined, so before it was mostly strategies, but now it's risks. And I want to make sure that I more specifically refer to them so that it knows what this is. And let's see what happens when we try to have it just go through. Again, not structured, but at least they were bullet points. And we're going to wait and see how ChatGPT is able to group them. It's also basing this off of the past section that I have. So I'm hoping that the groups are fairly similar to what we have here. And already, this is pretty good stuff. So I'm going to pause, wait till it finishes up. Okay, so this took a little bit longer than I expected, but again, I took the risk factors, I just pasted them in, not the greatest format for me to read and understand, but I asked it to outline and summarize, group similar things, and output it in a way that made some sense. So this is the first pass that it had done, and actually that's already a lot more readable, trying to group it into things that make more sense for me, but I wanted to go even further, and this time I had a little bit more success with trying to ask it to flag things for me. So if I look for these, it helps me to not have to look at it quite so much and at least to focus on some things. So not all, it's not going to be perfect, but it does help me to understand a little bit better. So we're knowing that we need to have attract and retain subscribers. It's obvious. This is actually very useful. What are consumer preferences? So maybe we are spending all of our time describing the different products we have when we should be focusing or beefing up the different preferences that we have. Maybe it means that we need to create more content around different user audiences. And if there's a group of, let's say, personas that have one certain type of preference for our products, is that something that is being worked on? Is that something that we can support you on? Again, we're seeing competition in the market, brand awareness, brand reputation. Again, if reputation is important, then we want to own the product recalls and defects space rather than somebody else owning those. And one interesting thing here that I wouldn't have even noticed, and I wouldn't honestly have known about, is that Peloton is concerned it's a potential risk that they have third-party license for music content. Do they actually need to do anything with musical content? What are their plans for it? Do they have special playlists out there? Do they ever advertise it? Do they mention it? Do they need to create new content? Do they have influencers that are musicians that would be wanting to have some kind of potential relationship with them and creating exclusive content there? These are things that I don't know, but they are really good questions to ask so that we can start to be focused on the risks that are risks to the overall company, not just our day-to-day kind of thing. Anyways, hope this was helpful to you. Seer, as we're doing, this is just a quick and dirty way. There are a lot of different caveats. If you have too much information, I'm still just using the free version of ChatGPT. So I can't paste an entire 124 10K document into there. However, that is one of those kind of projects that Seer is exploring now, how to do a lot of the things that I'm showing you now just to scale. And we are definitely at the cusp of a whole new world where AI is going to be more on a daily basis of what we can do and helping to support us. So thank you very much.